store.
Where is the store?
Just
jump right in the middle of work the whole thing. We're going to start then in Luke 4, since you suggested doing that.
Same Luke chapter 4,
verse 18. Ways of the Lord. It's a very familiar scripture that we're looking at tonight. Ways of the Lord. When we begin reading it, you'll know exactly what we're talking about. Luke 4, 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Who's that talking here? Jesus talking. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and the recovering of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Praise God. And we're not going to preach on that. Not too much. Praise the Lord. It's a familiar passage, but what isn't so familiar is you might not realize where he read this from Isaiah from. I mean, not from the chapter of Isaiah, but what synagogue he was in when he read this. He was in a particular synagogue. It happened just after he come out of the wilderness, just after he had been baptized, just after the Holy Ghost had come upon him. He went into the wilderness, as we know, for 40 days he was out there, was given to the devil, and when he come back, he headed home. He headed to Nazareth. What an offer he had at Nazareth. We draw all that to verse 21 of that same place, and he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. He told them right off at hometown Nazareth, he told them, this scripture is fulfilled in your ears. He was saying, I am the Messiah. I am the one that you have been looking for centuries. Hallelujah. It was letting them know who he was. That's why I read that passage, and he said it was fulfilled in their ears. And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth, and they said, is not this Joseph's son? And then they proceeded, if you need to turn it down or whatever you want to do with it, it'll be all right.
Carry on.
Hallelujah. Again, I can carry on. Hallelujah. All right. Drop it on down to verse 28. After they talked about this thing, they heard his gracious words. They heard him read out of the text in Isaiah and stating that it was fulfilled in their ears. Now he goes on down, and all the innocent synagogue, when they heard these things, how did they detect it? Were filled with wrath. They hated him. They hated him. This hometown boy, they hated him. shed his blood for us. He knew us while we were yet sinners. Yet he loved us. But many times our being familiar with people, it brings contempt for them because we see the faults in them.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. As we stand here, we've all met each other several different times, and we're familiar with each other. But I have never had to walk in Brother Mike's shoes. If I'm not careful, I could be contempt. I would think he was contemptible by the way he's handling things. I don't believe I am, but I'm just talking here. Hallelujah. Because I don't know him. He has a different personality.
Right.
Different characteristics.
Right.
Is that his fault? That's the way God made him. That's his DNA. God designed him for certain tasks. And if I'm not careful and I think he's contemptible, I can think I'm believing the work of God is contemptible because God designed him for a that people choose to say why they don't come to church, why they reject Christ, why they no longer in church, why they no longer serving the Lord, is because they really never got to know Him. And they're just familiar with Him. They was familiar with His Word. They didn't know the Word. They was familiar with it. They could maybe quote Psalm 23. They might be able to quote the Lord's Prayer. Maybe a couple other verses. They were familiar with that. But I'll tell you, if you want to get to know God, it's about Him right here. People that tell you they know God, and I can have you read this letter, tell me, oh no, I don't need to do that. You don't know God.
That's right.
For a fact, I don't care who they are. They haven't read it. They don't know Him. They're familiar with God. Their familiarity may run deep. They're familiar with passages of Scripture. Hallelujah. But before we pass judgment on somebody, what somebody said, what they said, and that they said, we need to hear the whole story. The whole story goes from cover to cover. It's not just a few verses in there. Hallelujah. Pieces have been taken out many different times to say, well, this Bible is just nothing because it just contradicts itself. Well, I contradict myself every day the same way. Sometimes they say yes to the day, and other times to the day I say no. Well, I contradict myself all day. Sometimes I say yes, sometimes I say no. Don't you do the same? Well, sometimes in our life, as Lord unfolded the Word to us, sometimes He said yes, sometimes He said no. He contradicted the yes and the no. He said that if you do this, I'll bless you. If you don't do this, I'll curse you. A blessing and a cursing. Well, that's confusion. That's contrary one to another. Well, you need to remember why Papa pulled this strap down. You remember what blessings and cursings are about. Hallelujah. We were raised in a way that we can't understand this. Maybe some younger ones of the day can't understand because they didn't become acquainted with that strap. Or whatever else Ben felt like picking up at the time. I didn't know which was it. I knew what a true Ben was. And God gave me a strong back. Hallelujah. Maybe we mind, but He gave me a strong back that I survived. Praise the Lord, and I don't regret a single day of it now that I know the Lord. All those things is what brought me to Christ and made me who I am today. It was in the pattern of God from the beginning. So don't think I detest anything that is well in my life. I have had some great failures in my life, but it's all part of my life now. It makes me who I am today. It's for my shoes and walk. Some people have found me contemptible. I know, because I've had many different ones crushed into my face. I've been spit upon. I've had dirt thrown on me. I've had pieces thrown at me. I've been condemned by loved ones, condemned by people that don't even know me. And that's just what happens to me. I don't know what happens to you. Hallelujah. But I thank God if you want to get to know me. Hallelujah. Maybe you'll find all those faults as you, as we're talking about here. Just being familiar with me. You'll find out there's some things that you don't like about me. And then you'll find out some things that I don't like about you. But we need to love each other. Until we get to know each other. But more importantly, first off, we need to develop that relationship with God. We need to know Him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. And since now, His hometown folks knew Him personally, or they thought they knew Him personally, but they knew didn't know Him. People today will tell you, well, if Jesus was walking around here, and He was telling us, I would leave Him, I'd follow Him. I've heard Him say that different times. Well, if Jesus said it, then if I could hear with my ears from Jesus' lips, well, don't you know there's going to be a thousand years that Jesus is going to come down and sit on the throne? They have sprung in Jerusalem, and He's going to minister with His lips to the whole world, and His one world government of Jesus Christ. And you know what's going to turn loose out of the pit. Everybody charges against Jesus Christ to try to kill him.
Well, man is full of sin. Chicken and iniquity. My God, we need to give the Lord know who Jesus is. We might not see him in the flesh, but we can read all about him. Now, John said that if everything was written that Jesus said and done, the world could not, the book contain the books that it would take to write all those things. Think about that. The world could not contain the books that all the things Jesus had done and said was written down. Well, I can tell you that this book does not cover very much room in the world. This is all we have. This is it. And still, people will not accept this word. Inspired by God. Prove many different ways that this is the voice of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. I won't get into different versions today, but the King James is one we need.
Amen.
And isn't that false? Probably. But this is my answer to that all the time. They've had 400 years to write 400 more and more books about all the false that are in here. The new versions, they've had 20 years, 40 years, 50 years, none of them over 100 years. And one particular version, they changed every 10 years. So by the time you think figured all the things that's not quite right, and they changed it, so now you guys start all over again. But this one's been around for over 400 years now. And I'm not trying to tell you that everything you didn't hear the exact, but I'm pleased with all what God's did. I never want to say, well, when I'm trying to work out a situation in my life and in the church and in the world, and I've had over 40 years of ministry to do some work on that, and I never turned to that passage of Scripture and said, well, that was translated wrong. This is the way it should be translated. No, why? I don't speak Greek, and I don't need to speak Hebrew. Don't read it. Don't write it. Don't need to. Other folks have done it. They translated this word, and I accept that word. It's been around a long time. Praise God. And why am I spending this much time on it? Because familiarity breeds contempt.
Amen.
You can ask people, and I'll just use this as an example, about the King James Version of
I can remember for years, and find that when they found out Inspiration of the Holy Ghost. That's the only way to
me. There's another one my wife had. We purchased them at the same time. On August 6th, 2009, we had Bibles already. We had King James Version, Constantine Reference Bibles. We got them fast as big as Bibles they had. And I'll tell you, when I tried to hold them to preach out of, that was good to study with, but it wasn't good to preach out of. So we purchased these for either Christian and Read Bibles, because it's got a nice print in it. Hallelujah. So we purchased them on August 6th, 2009, for the occasion of after I retired. Now, I've been here before, but after I retired, not here, but over there. After I retired in 2009, we was here August 6th, 2009, to preach revival here in this place, our first revival after that we retired from that full time in the evangelistic work. We was here, we got this Bible. How is this? 2009, we preached out this Bible. It's marked up quite a bit. It's getting a little tattered. I had to put a little tape on. I just put it on my backpack on hers. But they keep on going, and we'll keep on going. I haven't found another one. I thought it's getting pretty lightly, but I haven't found a replacement for it yet. And what I do, I have to do all these markings and colors in it, so I still don't want to do that. Even though I just read it now, this particular Bible, I've read it at least four times from front cover to back. I held a revival down in Jarrett, Louisiana, and I flat totally lost my voice. Could only get a squeak down. My wife had to preach the whole revival. Thank God was at a church that believed that the Holy Ghost could move on a woman and preach. Hallelujah. Praise God, because she preached the whole thing. Thank God. Hallelujah. I tried to squeak out a little bit at the end of the year. But the Lord told me, if you will read that Bible from cover to cover orally, out loud. Well, now that happened no more, so that's exactly what I did. Text your wall to read it out loud. I can read faster to myself. Praise the Lord. But even after doing all that, this thing is, His Word is alive. And you read His Word, and I am familiar. Already talked about how that's not necessarily good. But I am familiar with the Word, but sometimes I don't know the Word. But as you're reading it, going through it again, that makes you more familiar with it, and you go from familiarity to I know this passage. Hallelujah. And sometimes it jumps out alive at you. That's what all the poetry says. Oh, right now. Now that is good to know the Lord in reality of His Word. Praise God. Here's where we need to get familiar with God. A lot of people are looking for a thrill, for a chill, for some excitement. My oh my. We'll find it in many places in our life for Christ, but we'll find that we need to have that anchor in His Word, all of His Word. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we're going to keep on going and getting deeper in His Word. It was the Word that Jesus read in His hometown that they found contemptible.
All right.
To the place that they were mad. They had wrath towards Him and was going to kill Him. But through His power, He just walked away from them, and nothing that they could do was not time for man. Hallelujah. The same passage, about the same occurrence, Matthew writes about in Matthew 13:54. We'll read a few verses there. And when he came down to his own country, he taught them in the synagogue. Doesn't tell you there what he taught, but in Luke we read what he read out of Isaiah. But here in Matthew, it just tells us that he taught them in the synagogues, insomuch that they were astonished and said, "Whence hath this man this wisdom and these mighty works? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brethren James and Joseph and Simon and Judas?
Yeah.
And his sisters, are they not all of us? Whence then hath this man all know him. They knew the names of the family, but they didn't know him, because he wasn't the son of Joseph. He wasn't the carpenter's son. You see, they didn't know a particular thing with whom the whole thing was right, that he was the son of God. And he kind of revealed himself to them, to the home folks. You know, when we come to the Lord, who's the first our point of contact to try to get them into the Lord? It's usually a family member we talk to. And usually the result is just what Jesus had here. They can find a high enough lift and throw you off of it. If not an actual event, they will do it in the mind. Well, you're just done. You just done well off your head now. Get out of your mind now. Just go on. Leave you alone. But that's where we go. That's what Jesus went. To deal with his family, to deal with his neighbors, and let them know who he was. The rest of the world might have been surprised, but he let his hometown know who he was.
Right.
And they were the first.
They were
rejected. You see, many people say that when he went into his own received him not. He just said, oh, the Jews didn't accept him. Well, yeah, it was the Jews, but it is more closer down to that. Hallelujah. It's his home folks that he grew up around, that he could call every one of them that said in that synagogue by name, because he'd been around them, he was raised around them, and they didn't even know him. And how many people out around him don't even know Jesus Christ, even though Jesus Christ's body meets here regularly, and they don't know that this is their hometown. People around here that were born here and raised here and don't know that Jesus comes in here to services and meets with his body and his people.
You need to know some words of God's message and move someplace else. Because